Now, before we go into detail how we're going to write the scripts and the controls for the main menus, we're actually going to go into the level, which you will find in the scenes. You will already have all these things set up. Now, maybe better yet, let's not go into the level, let's go into the test level, which is exactly the same as the level, but it has a prefab that we have for the characters. Now, you will already have the prefabs for the fighter objects into you, the project you will download. But let's see what needs to be added. On the later part, we're going to focus on what goes into these scripts and how we can actually create this controller. But what we want to have basically is a component that it's called input handler and a state manager. And most importantly, the state manager is what it's important over here, and we're going to see why in a bit. So create two scripts, one called state manager and one called input handler, and we are ready to go back into the intro. Now I'm not going to really focus on that cinematic over there. It's just three sprites. Okay, the body and the two hands, and the two hands just follow two other game objects where the hands were supposed to be, and the body has a shake script that is also in the package, and it makes him look like he's jumping around. Now this is completely taken from Street Fighter. I like that and I wanted to recreate that, so I use this. And this also has a different, it doesn't have a sprite material, it has a material with a standard shader on cutout, and I also added a normal map so I can move, so it looks a bit more detailed, even though it's just the same. Okay, now this has, the light also has a light flicker, which we're not going to see at all. Now, on the important stuff, on the canvas, we basically have a text, which should be over here, which just says press start, even though we're going to be pressing a space. And the other most important thing is that we have two options. One is for single player, which supposedly be one player and the AI. We were not going to see the AI, at least as part of these first videos. We might do it later, but I've already done an AI script, an AI video from the old series, and it's not going to be that much different. You can simply integrate that if you want to, and I'll see what I'll do in the future for that. And the second option will be player versus player, or two players, or everything you might want to add. Now this series is going to be more tailored for player versus player, and one character versus one character basically. But with a few changes, you can also add the more popular, what is right now, I think it's more popular that to have more brawlers like 4x4 or 3-for-all, and where you have four different characters, and we're not really going to, with a few changes you can actually use this for a lot of other stuff. Now let's focus on the menus. Basically these two are they are buttons, but they don't really have to, since you're not supposed to use the mouse anyway, but we're simply going to make them interactable, or if you do not want them to be interactable, just unselect these ones. Now the more important thing to have is this script over here, which is called button reference. Now, this basically has a reference that says that says that refers the other game object over here, which is the one we enable when to indicate that this option is selected, and we assign that over here. And if it's selected, it just enables or disables that game object. The select indicator on start, it simply disables it. And this also needs to be serializable, because on the other script we're going to see, on the intro scene manager, we want to have that inside an array, so we want to have both options. Okay, this one and this one, we want to have both options into an array, and we're going to call them menu options. Now you can add a lot more options, it doesn't matter. The other things we're going to use is also the namespace of the Unity Engine scene management, which is this is for 5.3 and top only. If you are not, if you are on a previous version of Unity, then this namespace is not included, and I'll tell you in a bit where you have to do a few changes. Unity Engine UI, because we're going to probably, well, actually we're not even going to need this one, but let's keep it, doesn't matter. Now, the reference to the start text, which is press start, timer, loading level, and if we have initialized, if we are actually pressed start or space in our case, and the active element, the menu object, which is the whole this game object that has all the options we want to have in here. And I'll explain what this is. On start, we simply disable the menu object, so it disables both of the menus, of the options, or basically all the main menu. Now, on update, if we haven't yet initialized, which is we haven't yet pressed space, now of course this is completely optional, this is just for effect, or just to make it look more retro, like the old fighting games we were playing. Okay, now we basically want to flicker the press start text. We simply add on the timer and we reset it, and we say set active. We simply wait for half a second and enable and disable the start text. Now, if we press space or start, basically space or the jump button, which is still goes to space, we initialize it to true, we disable the start text, the menu object will be also true, we enable the menu, then we are starting. If we are not already loading the level, we need to have on the selected element that we to indicate that we actually have that element unselected. So we say on the menu options, on the active element, make that selected to true. And that goes in turn over here and makes the select indicator for each of these two. It just enables either this one or this one. We basically, how we navigate between the options, if we press the up or the down arrow, or you can change that to any of the other inputs you have on for your own games. Basically this one will not work for if you have a controller, so you probably want to change this. And basically changes the previous active element, it either subtracts or resets it the active element. Okay, just an integer, and or either adds or makes it at zero if you press the down key. And if we hit speed, if we hit space again, we take it as selecting, an option, and then we go and load the level. We have also a debug.log to load level. We are indeed loading the level. We start a coroutine that says load level, and we say we just raise a bit the local scale of the option we selected, and we've already done that. So the coroutine, it's going to go over here and call this coroutine. Now, based on the selection we have over here, it's going to come into this function from inside the coroutine, and this is hard-coded, and on our the next script we're going to see is the character manager, which is also a singleton, which where we use the get instance, and basically we say how many of number of active users we're going to have. In the first case, which is the single player, we're only going to have number of users as one. In the second case, we're going to have two users, which will be two players. By users, I mean somebody that actually controls the player, or the character, if you will. Now, whenever I say users, or user means a human person. If I say player, it might mean either a human person or an AI. So, the other thing that we're going to see on the character manager is changing, having different types of players, as I explained right now, with those players can be users or AI or simulation, and we're going to see each one when the time comes. So for the second case, since we were having two users, we need to go into the player list and change the player type for the second player to be a user too. Then we come over here and we say wait for 0.5 seconds, although this is not that you don't really have to wait for that much, not for that much. I just did it for effect. So when you select something, it just shows that you actually selected. Okay, it's just an artificial wait. We just simply disable everything, or the start text, which is we're not even going to use this actually. So let's delete this and this. And then we call the scene manager, and we call the new function. You can either call load scene or load scene async. It's not wrong whatever which one you're going to use, especially in the project this light. But you usually want to prefer loading a scene asynchronous, so it doesn't seem like your Unity has freezed or your game has freezed. So basically what this does is loads a level, and until it doesn't give control to the new level until it has completely loads one level. If you just use load scene, then it will make it so that until the new level is loaded, that your scene has freezed. The scene we're going to call, which is the select scene, and select load scene mode is some new stuff or some new options Unity added. If you want to call it additive or single, if you call it additive, you're going to have both of these scenes together, which is something we don't want, so we're going to call it single. Now, if you are not in Unity 5.3, then the old way you were loading was application.loadLevel additive or additive async or load level async and say the name of the level. But since we are in Unity 5.3 and I'm actually going to add a little comment over here. Okay, and it will load your level. But before we go to the next level, we're going to see another important script, which is the character manager. Character manager is one of your most important scripts, which is going to hold a lot of information for us. One of which is the number of users, so how many active users you'll be having in your game, on your in our current session. And we have two lists. One is the players, one is the character list. The character list, you can call it like a resource list, or if you have a lot of levels, you can add another list over here with all your levels and call your levels from there. But I mean the levels that your players, your characters is going to actually fight in. And basically the character list has every prefab from, and you need to assign basically the prefabs from all your characters, all your fighters. You need to assign them the prefabs and the character IDs, so in turn you can actually find what ID goes to what fighter prefab. And the player list is what I've talked before, which goes into every player must have a player ID, an input ID, what type of player it is. If they are both AI, okay, it's going to use when you are actually fighting, it's going to pit AI versus AI. Simulation is more for multiplayer stuff, which we're not going to see. If you have character, is if you actually have select character, and the player prefab and the player states is what we assign a bit later from the next two scenes. And the score is actually how many turns he has won, or the character, the player has won. Now, you'll notice that input ID, the first one has nothing. It's not, it's an empty string. But the second one is input ID 1. The reason for this is because we take the input ID and we add it on the input, on our input names. And if you go into edit project settings input, you'll come over here. Now on the project you will download, it will has already all this stuff set up, but let's see what we're actually doing. Horizontal, we have to disable by default the stuff Unity has by default. It has a alternative negative and alternative positive button for horizontal, for vertical. You need to clear all this stuff up, and unfortunately the only way to do that is either by an input manager from the asset store or just do it by hand. I did it by hand. So, okay, the new axis you have to make is horizontal 1. This is for the second player and all the input that has to do with the second player, and this is for the first player. The importance is that this one does not have anything after the horizontal. If it did, then on my character manager, on my input ID, I have to add the what was next after the horizontal. And I hope this is clear. So in case for the second player, both horizontal, vertical, fire, everything, even if it's fire level. But okay, you need to have, it's important, but other than the basic names we have in front, to add the input ID. So since you are going to download the project, I'm not going to go a lot more into detail on this. So let's see the character manager from the inside. Number of users, we talk what this is. This is the player. Let's see the definition for the player base. You need to have it serializable, since we're using it in a list. The player ID, input ID, the player type, and everything else. If we have selected the character, the actual player prefab, which we select from the select screen. The state manager is the reference to the actual created character inside your level, inside where you actually fight, and the player types. Okay, user AI simulation. We need another list for the character list, the character base, character ID, and the corresponding prefab. We also need to have two functions. We need to have one function that returns us the character based from an ID. So we pass the ID over here. We search every entry into our character list, and if its character ID is the same as the ID we are searching for, it returns the return value, it returns that character list, and we can also add a break over here. The next function is to return a player from states. So if you are in actual fighting, in the actual fight, if we want to pass the reference from the created character, we pass his state manager, and it searches inside the player list, and it returns that player from the player states. It will return the player base, so from there you can have the score, you can have everything else. And this is also, character manager is also a singleton, which means that we can access it from anywhere by calling the getInstance function. We set up the instance in the awake, and we also need to use don't destroy on load, since this is this game object, we're going to be taking it in all the levels we're going to be playing. So we say don't destroy a load this game object. So this will come into or into play in a bit later. And that's pretty much what you need to have. Zone doesn't even, and I don't think I've forgot anything, and I didn't. So let's move to the select screen. Select screen, let's save. Now, before we start seeing into, now if I hit play, it's going to give an error because we do not have the character manager. So we're not going to hit play, but we're going to see a little bit the setup of the select screen. We have our character select grid, and we have its portrait inside over here. This, the character select grid has a grid layout group, and I can set it up like this, or everything else, or like that. Now, we're going to hard code this. By meaning hard code is we're going to set this up from the start, like I've did, and it's already ready in the project you have. Now, for every portrait, we're going to actually create another script that is going to be called portrait info. This script will only hold three variables. It's the position it has on the grid, on the X, and on the Y. So the other variable is going to have is the character ID, which is what corresponds to the character manager from the first level, which is the ID we actually coming into the character manager and say character ID, and we pass we return the prefab. Okay, we assign that to every portrait, but we're not going to go into each one and write its position. So for instance, only the first one, this portrait, has to be position 0, 0. So the last one should be 2 and position X on the 1 and position Y on 2. But we do not want to do that for every portrait. We're going to write that with script. And that's basically the important thing over here. The other important thing is that we have two game objects. Player 1 visualization position, player 2 visualization position. Okay, this is the place where we are going to create the characters from player 1 and player 2. Select screen manager is the next script we are going to see. Let's open it. Select screen manager. This is where a lot of stuff come into play. We need reference both to the UI, to our list, and our scene management. Number of players is the same as number of users. How many users we have, actual humans that we're going to be playing. Player interfaces. Let's go to definition. Now, for every variable we're going to have for each player, and those variables are the active portrait, with basically what portrait is actually the one active, the preview portrait, if it had any, the selector is on the canvas, the selector for player 1 and player 2. I have it, and you should have it also disabled. It's just two images with image type sliced, and it should be interactable. It should either be buttons anyway, but it doesn't hurt doing that. Let's make it a little bit more, not be transparent. Okay. It's basically what indicates that the current portrait is active or not. Let's close this. Let's go back into VS and say the character visualization position is what I said. The actual game object in the 3D world where we're going to instantiate the characters. And the created character is the preview character. When we select a character, the figure we have on either on the left or on the right. The active X and active Y is the starting and portrait is the current one that is active for each player. Now, because if you are holding down the down or your keys, basically it was going too fast changing between portraits and characters, so that didn't look that good. So we have a few variables for smoothing that out, and we also have references to the player base, which is in turn on the character manager. Okay, we have a reference over there so that we can save it when we need it and call it when we need it. We're not going to use the state manager. Select screen manager. Let's go back up. Portrait info and portrait prefabs is basically all the portraits we have over here. We also need to add them one by one inside your, yeah, you do not need to add them. We add them by adding from the portrait canvas. So you do not, you don't want to do that. Max X, max Y is how many we have on the X, how many we have on the Y. The grid is so that we are actually selecting stuff from inside the grid or portraits. And the portrait canvas is the game object over here, which is going to take all the game objects that have a portrait info component, and it's going to assign them inside this array. If we are loading a level, and if both players have selected a character, a reference to our character manager, and the select screen manager is also a singleton, even though I might not use it, but it doesn't really hurt to have it. So anyway, next on start, we need to set up the reference to the character manager, the number of players we take from how many number of users we have set on the character manager, and we go and start creating the grid. We initialize the grid since it's a new portrait info, and we set the double integer with max X and max Y. We need to start with X and Y both to be at 0. Portrait prefabs, we assigned every component. Keep in mind, this calls for components, not component. It goes and takes every component, every game object that has the component portrait info and assigns it in the array. Now, for every portrait we have over here, we start go and assign the position X and Y based on what this X and Y is. After we assign the first one, we assign this onto the grid. We replace what the grid already had, which was an empty portrait info. We replace that with a new one from the array, and we check if we reach the maximum value we can have on the X, minus 1. If we haven't reached it, we add to the X. Else, we make the X 0 and we go Y plus plus. We add on the Y. Now keep in mind that this need to be exact with how many you have over here. So this will go into 2 and this will go into 3. Max X, 2 and 3. If you have more portraits, you need to change this a bit, and this will probably not work if you are going if one of these lines is not they are not symmetrical, so you have more into one or more into other, or and less in the other. So keep that in mind. Let's close the start, and then on update, if we are not already loading the level, then we need to check for how many, for all our player interfaces, for how many number of players we actually have, number, in this case players are users, and for each one, if it hasn't already selected the character, we set up the reference to the player base for that player interface, and we call these three functions. One handles the selector position, basically finds the active portrait and places the selector over that active portrait. The second will handle the input for that player and that user in our case, and it also needs to pass the player interface of that player, and we also need to pass the input ID, since these can be two different users, we need to also know the ID of each one. And we also need to handle how we create and visualize the active portrait, the character that has the every portrait basically. If a player interface, if we the eye is greater than the players we can have, it takes it like it's an AI, so it says it already has selected a character, okay, so don't bother with it. Now this basically is the meat of where you how you select a character, but before we go into depth with them, let's go into the next things we have inside our update, which is a statement that says if both players have selected, that means both players have a character, that means let's load the level that we want to play. We start the coroutine, we load the level with a coroutine called load level, and we say load level is true, so don't bother with this for loop. Else, if we haven't already selected, check to see that if the first player has selected a character and the second has already selected a character, then that means both players have both players selected, so make both players selected to be true. Okay, this is very simple. Let's see the coroutine of load level before we go into the other stuff. This is simple, but we first need to see if we have a player that is not a user, that is an AI. So we go and check into our character manager, we go into our player list and check everything, every player or every entry if you wish, and check to see that if it's an AI character and its player prefab is null, create a random value between 0 and the length of all our portraits prefab, and assign a prefab with random value, basically randomly add a prefab from the characters we can have. So it goes and says character, the player that is an AI, its player prefab goes into the character manager, it calls that function we talked about, which was the return character with ID, and the ID you want to pass is an entry from your portrait prefabs array with a random value, and we pass that entry's character ID, and we pass the prefab, and we also have a debug log that says what character ID what character ID was selected. Now I only have three prefabs, so a lot of it is repeated. Okay, so keep that in mind, and that's why I have the debug log over here. And after that, you can have gear repair new. Wait for 2 seconds so the characters play that kick animation. And you can call load the scene manager, load scene, and load the next level the way we talked before. Now let's see the three functions that is based on what player. Basically, why I encapsulate all the functions into their own separate functions, or basically why I encapsulate all the logic into their own functions that take the player interface, is because we have multiple users. So if I want to have four players, this logic is going to run independently for four players, or how many players I actually want to have, and that is really neat and pretty powerful. Let's say the first one, handle selector position, code definition. So whatever you see, the PL stands for that user player. We enable its selector. We find the active portrait, which goes into the grid and says, "With that is the active X and that is the active Y. So return me the portrait that has this position." We need to find the vector 2, which is the selector's position. We do that by finding, taking the local position from the transform. And to actually find the selector position, we can do selector position plus new vector 2 and call, we need to add the offset of the portrait canvas, local position X, and the local position Y. We basically add the local position of the canvas, but since it's a 3D game object, if you directly add the transform.localPosition, you will be getting an error because it was going to say to you that you are adding a vector 2 to a vector 3. That's why you need to break it up like this. Okay. You basically find the selector position and you add the position of the canvas. So if you move the canvas around, it will still keep the correct position. And we pass the selector position over here. The local position will be the selector position for that selector. Now this is simple. This is how you select which portrait is active or not. And based on your input, we will have into our handle select screen input. We go into definition. If we open, it's already open. Grid navigation is how we basically navigate inside the grid. And here's where the player ID or input ID comes into play. We need to create a float, which is the vertical, if we are pressing up and down. But we also need to add the player ID. So if it's the first player, we will have vertical plus player ID, since the first player's player ID is let's go back into the intro. We want a character manager. Since the first player's player ID, input ID, the player ID is player 1, okay. Input ID is empty. It's not a space, not 1, not 2, empty. Okay, that is kind of important. Then that means it looks for an axis that has the name vertical. This axis is already by default in Unity and it's the vertical. Okay, a simple and elegant solution to something that it's not so elegant. Anyway, so we have our axis. we have our input and it's only assigned to one player. If that axis is not zero, that means there's movement. The player, the user, hit one of his buttons. If he doesn't have pressed it before in the span of a few seconds, we check to see if the vertical is lower, if it's negative, if or if it's positive. Now, if it's positive and the active Y is greater than 0, positive means that it pressed the up button. So we need to check if the active Y is greater than 0 or if not. If it's not greater than 0, that means that the active, that the character is on either of the this portrait. So to go greater than or lower than 0, basically because we want to go up, okay, if we were over here, then the next entry will have been a position that it does not belong on the grid. So basically, think of it, if it goes like this, 0, 1, 2, and we were already at 0, if we hit up, the position it will be requesting will be minus 1. There's no position that there's no minus 1 position, so that means an error. Okay, we check if the Y is greater than 0. If it's not, if it's greater than 0, then we subtract. If not, we assign it to be the maximum Y minus 1. Maximum Y is 3, there's no position 3, so we always need to subtract 1, since we always start by from 0. If the vertical was negative, exactly the same, but the other way around. Instead of checking if it was greater than 0, we check if it's lower than the maximal Y minus 1. And if it was, we can add to the active Y, or we can make it 0. And we say that you've clicked the input once. Same for the horizontal. Okay. And we have the timer, and you can add also this over here. It won't do much different. Okay, we have the horizontal, and we turn input once, so that means we press at least one, we move the position at least once. We need to check if both vertical and horizontal are zero, so there's no input. We reset the hit it once to false. Now, if it keep it like this, to change characters, the player, the user, will have to press once to change position. And if you want to change once again, he need to leave the button and press it again. But that doesn't always feel right or nice. So we say, if he has already pressed once the input, we add to the reset timer and we say timer to reset. If it's greater than 0.8, we reset the hit input once to false, and timer to reset, we also set it to 0. And that is how you navigate inside the grid of portraits. So, assuming you got that correct, you can now select or hover over over portraits. We continue on and we say if that player presses his fire one, or in our case his punch button, plus the player ID. Okay, we talk what the player ID is. Make a reaction to the character, so go to that created character, get his animator and play the animation we have kick, and we say pass the character to the character manager. Okay, we go to the player base, to the player prefab, and we assign that. We find the corresponding prefab by using the ID of the active portrait, and we assign that prefab. Now this part could have been skipped if on your portrait info had also assigned the prefab, but this way is a lot more organized, even though it might not seem so, but trust me, it is. Okay, and that means that this player has actually selected a character. Now there's actually no way to deselect right now, but if you want to deselect a character, you only have to say to on another input, or let's actually add this. Let's actually see how easy it is to add it. Okay, instead of pressing fire 1, you can press fire 2 and it will make this false. And let's test it, because why not? Oops, yeah, not single. Because if it's single, it's, if you select the character, it's going to go back. So I'm going to select this guy. It plays. It doesn't play right now. If I click the fire 2, if I find it first, which one was? Let's check what does inside the character manager. It says that it has a character, and now that I think of it, it's not going to run since we select over here. If it has selected the character, then it cannot come into, it won't come into this function. So let's take that from there and add it over. Add over here, but since there is no player ID, we will say player interface I dot let's take it this way instead of using the player interface. Okay, input ID, let's delete this one. Or not. Yeah, this won't work. Player interface I dot player base. So this is the correct way, probably. Let's see it again. Restart to players. I select my first character. I click the deselect, and as you can see, the hash character is not selected. And I can select again. I can select, deselect, and it works like a charm. Let's go back into our scripts. Let's see the last function, which is handle character preview. Let's go to definition. Handle character preview. If you have the preview portrait, if previous portrait, and that previous portrait is not the same as the active portrait, we come into our logic over here. If there was already a character created, we simply destroy the previous one. Okay, there's no pooling over here. You can have object pooling, but it's not really that necessary in the scale of a project like this, and in a scene like this, it's not really that important. Then we create a new one. We instantiate, we find the character ID. We find the prefab by using the character ID of the active portrait. We assign it to that player's visualization position. We do not care about rotation, and we say instantiated as a game object. The created character will be the created game object. We basically assign the references. The preview portrait will be the active portrait, of course, and then we need to check if the player ID. But basically, we are checking if it's not the first player, and by first player is, I mean, since we only have two players, okay, this is where the tailoring for two players comes into play, the one I meant. We have one player over here, and we have the other player over here. This is the first player, this is the second player. If it's not this player, we want to rotate this player, this character, to look towards the other player, since this will always be looking like this because its prefab looks like this. The way we're doing this, or we are doing this, is on the state manager we have a behavior over here that says look right or not, and it goes into the sprite renderer under the animator. It goes to the sprite renderer and flips the X or not. You see that I cannot deselect this because it's controlled by the state manager, which we'll see on a later video. Okay. So, how we know if it's not the first player? If it doesn't have the same ID as the first player, then that means it's not the first player. This is a little bit of hard coding. Anyway, so that's basically it, how you select players, and you go, and when both of the players have selected, it goes and loads the level. So if you also only had only one player, then it would have gone and directly to the other player entries, or how many types of players you can have. It will have said that they already have selected a character, and it will have gone and start the coroutine to load the next level. And I think we haven't forget anything, so that means we are actually going to stop the video over here, and I'll see you on the next part.